You are listening to the Sauce Podcast. Recorded live deep beneath historic downtown Seneca Falls, New York, in the FingerLakes1.com studios. Featuring Dandy, Dandy, Tony Sometime, and Saucy Joe. And now, good evening, Sauce Pod streamers from coast to coast. It's me, Tony Sometimes, and this is episode number 64 of the Sauce Podcast, recorded live in the studios of FingerLakes1.com, deep beneath historic downtown Seneca Falls and Joe's Hots.
We're underneath Joe's Hots.
We're totally under Joe's Hots.
Too bad it's not open.
Till 2 o'clock tonight.
2 a.m.?
I don't know. I think so. I think they're opening for a bar scene tonight.
But they are going to be open tomorrow.
Definitely.
My big Monday night.
Monday night bar scene.
Hey, you should have seen it last Monday night at Reds.
It's true.
But I'm getting ahead of myself. It is Monday, August 6th, 2012, and tonight we're going to be talking about the landing of a rover on Mars early this morning. One way to outrun police on just a tractor. Another way to outrun police with the top down. A preacher that will beat the Lord right into you. The worst excuse for missing work ever. And a recap of last week's remote taco contest at Red's Place. And much, much more. Per usual tonight, I'm joined up here with my saucy compañeros, Saucy Joe.
Greetings and salutations. 64-bit episode this is tonight. Just saying. 64.
We're pushing all the bits.
Yep.
And Dandy, Aaron D.
I like bits.
Welcome back, Dandy.
Thanks.
Missed you at the Reds Place last week.
Yeah.
It was
yeah.
It was quite an episode. Thanks to Tiny Danger for sitting in.
Did a fine job.
Yep. And
welcome up here anytime.
Yeah, it'd been nice if you could have come up tonight to, you know, maybe become a regular part of the cast. But nonetheless, Tugboat Scotty, the official entry of Rudy P. Ringtone Productions, ate 31 tacos, and we saw each one of them go down. And I ate 3 Rocco's tacos tonight, and I'm full.
There was a report that all 31 of them came up afterwards.
Yeah, I believe that's true. All 3 contestants threw up, but it was an incredible night where... geez, how many tacos were eaten total by those 3 competitors? 59 plus 20 through 2 more?
70 some odd.
Yeah, a lot of tacos. A lot of tacos. All made by Rocco.
Everybody threw up?
All 3 threw up at some point after, yeah.
So then it doesn't count.
No,
because it counts.
It was the winner especially threw up well after the contest.
Yeah, he actually threw up at home. He texted in and said, "You should see how much food is in my toilet right now." I just vomited it all up.
Was he drunk?
Nope. He was drinking water. I can't believe you haven't seen the footage. It just goes to show.
Busy man. What do you want?
Gets better as the night goes on. And there was an electric atmosphere in the bar, without a doubt.
Why do you keep saying it was electric?
People were on the edge of their seats.
It was just electric. There were people standing up behind other people to get a better view. There was a lot of yelling. Billy Majors was clearly the favorite. And... people were urging him on, but he just got to a point where he couldn't take another bite. And Tugboat Scotty was 3 tacos ahead of him at that point, so he just sat back and let the clock run out.
Yep.
So congratulations to Tugboat Scotty on that last week's taco eating episode. How about that Mars rover? Saucy Mars Joe, rover. I know that you watched it
Curiosity.
Live. I fell asleep about 1 a.m., probably about... half hour before it actually landed.
I was up till about 3:15, 3:30 this morning, watching the I guess it's the NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Watching the footage of them cheering themselves on. They're all very happy as they checked all systems, and all systems were nominal. And then one by one, they went through the checklist. Then they started, entry. And everything was still nominal. It was going down. And they were all clapping every time they said it. We'd like a report from thermal. How's it going? And like, thermal reports, all systems are nominal. And they're like, yeah, woo! They're all clapping for themselves. And they're like, we need a report from, I don't know, whatever department. Other space words. And oh, woo, that one's good too. And then finally, here's the most amazing part I want to talk about. Is they got... they have two other basically satellites around Mars from previous missions that are they're orbiting around Mars, and they've timed it so that this landing last night or this morning, early this morning, would coincide with the orbit of it was Odyssey. Yeah, Odyssey, which actually could relay the data back to Earth, blah, 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 whatever. Anyway.
That's the most important thing, is that we can retrieve the data because the thing's on Mars. And
well, during entry, we lose contact with the new rover, you know, because it's like super hot and things are going on. It's got to put all its antennae away and whatnot. So Odyssey is relaying the data back to us, and then they got a visual. And then there's another Mars Observatory satellite thing that's floating around. It took an incredible picture of it with its parachute open. I don't know if you saw that image.
I can't wait till they release the video and everything.
Oh my gosh. So, but then here's what happens. These guys are in the JPL are so pumped up because they've been working on this forever, and these guys, this is what they do. Anyway, the thing lands, and they get like reports that it's landed and all systems are nominal yet again. And then, wouldn't you know it, right away it sends a picture back from Mars.
Yeah, as we were talking earlier, faster than we get NBC's Olympic footage.
Exactly. I already proposed that NASA broadcast the Olympics from 2016 in Rio, because what the hell? We got pictures from Mars.
Don't you think we should worry about fixing what's wrong with, like...
No, man, we got to find a new place to go once things get too fucked up around here.
If you can answer the question of can life exist on Mars, did life exist on Mars, then you can start to answer other questions.
We can't even... People can't even live and exist on Earth. Who the fuck cares about Mars?
We need more space. There's tons of space on Mars.
There's a lot. There's enough space here. I mean, do you have somebody that lives right on top of you? No.
The problem is that we as a species are always going to push our boundaries. And we've done it since as long as man has existed, whether it was Columbus sailing over the ocean or Lewis and Clark heading west with the help of Sacagawea. Or
fuck Columbus.
I just don't understand. Are you against...
I just think we should fix...
$2.5 billion price tag is probably what he's talking about. Yeah. There's $2.5 billion price tag on this project.
That's a couple jets. You know?
What about...
That's a couple military aircraft.
That's like half our debt.
That's not the way things work.
Our debt's is currently at $14
trillion. Yeah, that's just not the way things work with money on that level. It's all like... None of it's
real. If we didn't spend this $2.5 million, we wouldn't be $14.7 trillion.
$2.5 billion.
We wouldn't be $14.7 trillion.
Shimbashi says you're right, Dandy. In the chat room, by the way, anybody that wants to log into the chat room while they watch, you can click on the chat while you watch link right underneath the player. He also says congratulations are in order because apparently you won the pink taco eating contest. So,
see, that's funny.
I was hungry.
But yeah, it's Yeah, it's a lot of money, but man, what we did was historic, and there's a lot of things that are different about this rover. This one weighs like a ton.
It's a car.
Yeah, they used to drop in those rovers covered with air bubbles. Right. This one, they parachuted down through the atmosphere with some type of supersonic parachute, and it landed at 2 miles an hour so softly.
Well, because they lowered it down in a crane.
From the parachute.
Well, there's another platform that's got jets on it, and they couldn't get that close to the surface because it would kick up dust. So they keep that off the surface and lower it down on a crane, the rover.
Amazing.
And then it cuts the ropes.
It's amazing.
What? I just don't understand. Why would you...
Wait, what soundstage are they taping this at?
Well, if they did that, then it didn't cost that much money. and the money's somewhere out there anyway.
No, I don't give a shit about what goes on in space.
That wasn't the question. Let me finish the question. Are you one of those guys that's for cutting like all NASA funding?
We already cut it. So what's the sense of spending this money?
Well, because we now have a rover on Mars,
but we don't have a spaceship to bring anybody up to it.
Not yet. It's a series of small steps.
It transmits data like 3 million miles. It's something like I don't know. 1 or 2.3 million miles on average that Mars is away from the.
Okay, I want to know the data of what's going on east or west of us. Who gives a fuck about three?
You can find that out too.
Yeah.
I'm not saying
I don't care what's going on 3,000 or 3 million, however miles away. I just care what's going on east and west.
What about north and south? What's going on?
The weather
north?
Doesn't come from north and south. It comes from either west.
What about how long did it take that thing to get there? Like, when do we launch that?
I don't know. Hold on a second. I don't know that, but hold on. Are you saying that you're only interested in, like, weather data?
No.
My point being, or television or whatever else, none of those satellites would be in orbit without our space program. I just don't understand.
What does this space...
Your internet, all the modern conveniences you...
Why are you getting so
take
angry?
For granted? Because I just get pissed that people are disinterested or even against sometimes. Space exploration.
If everything was peaches and cream on fucking Earth, then I would be all for it. But we're in a big enough mess here. We don't need to be fucking checking out what's going on other planets. Let's figure out what the fuck's wrong here first.
Part of what we learn, though, from space exploration helps change things on this planet. As a matter of fact, if we never explored space, we wouldn't have satellites. We wouldn't have global communications.
That's what I just said. That's what I'm saying. It's crazy.
Well, us having a rover on Mars isn't going to help kids get better scores in fucking high school or people stop killing each other in the fucking ghetto. So.
No, it's not. But, neither will playing NBA basketball games or...
Neither will not having a rover on Mars.
And neither will researching
that money could have went
cancer.
Somewhere else.
Where?
To the fund to fight people from killing each other?
To the Romney campaign? Where do you want it to go?
That fucking guy. Did you know his father was born in Mexico in a... fucking Mormon cult camp?
Well,
not cult, but...
Yeah.
Fucking guy.
Yeah, well, he's Mormon.
But Mitt Romney's, like, totally against illegal aliens. His father's an illegal alien.
Well, if you notice, Mitt Romney doesn't really tell us anything about what he would do. He's very...
Right.
Because the theory is that, and we're totally switching topics here, but the theory is that a neutral, totally neutral Republican will be able to beat Obama. The only way that Romney can lose is if he keeps talking.
Is if he goes one side or the other.
Yeah, if he starts giving his plans.
He has to stay center of the aisle.
He needs to stop talking. He sounds dumber than Bush.
Well, I'm not pleased at all. I'll probably vote.
It's actually entertaining to listen to that guy talk. Every country he goes to, he just fucking says something really stupid.
Well,
it'd be like me running for president.
Except
the millions of dollars that I have in the Cayman Islands, way more
money. He's got three houses that are worth a total of like $15 million. Four houses.
I hope Joseph Smith.
He could have freaking funded a satellite trip.
Yeah, he could have fucking bought half that satellite.
That's one man. I'm just saying, the money. That's not that much money.
What's that?
Curiosity, the Mars rover. It's really not that much money. It's nothing.
Well, it's $2.5 billion, but in comparison to our overall budget, nothing. It's not. It's like in your household budget, it's probably like, I don't know, the phone bill. You know what I mean? It's like one. It's just probably less in your household. It's probably like one night ordering out pizza.
Right.
In your household budget.
Sandusky's daycare said, Romney never said, let me up in that shit.
No.
Or up in that bitch.
No.
Well, everybody's getting political up here.
Yep.
I don't really get too excited about debating presidents because honestly, I think that they're one and the same, honestly.
They are.
I don't know what's happening. The reason they're putting Romney up against Obama is because Obama's going to win, and then the Republicans are thinking, give this guy his second term, and then they can just fucking, after he really puts us in the ground, they can just sweep next election.
Well, Romney's basically running because he had the most money. I mean, when Republicans or Democrats look to put a presidential candidate up, the number one thing is he going to be able to generate or provide funds to fund the campaign?
Right.
Because it's a money race.
Obama, being the incumbent, doesn't need to have all that money.
Yeah. The Republicans are just biting the bullet for the next 4 years, and then.
Okay. Don't ever underestimate the right wing in America.
Oh God! If Mitt Romney becomes president,
what? What would happen?
What would happen?
We're all going to move to Mexico, fight the drug cartels for Joseph Smith.
Sounds like a plot of a great movie.
Well, on a lighter note, I had a funny little story this week. About a month ago, come home from, we got some more good stuff in the chat room.
No.
No? I was laughing it up.
A lot of, yeah, you started talking politics and people just love to debate it. I hate debating politics because,
pointless,
especially with someone from the other side.
It's more
because you're not going to change their opinion. No. You're just going to get them very angry.
When's the last time someone was like, "Ah, yeah, you're right. You know, I see your point."
I am voting for Romney.
There's a fight going on in the chat room.
There you go, man.
That's where it
politics
belongs. To the internet,
not over politics.
That's where politics belongs. What's it over me?
Shibashi said, "Is calling somebody out for their screen name. You wish you were the Prince of Fort Pierce."
Oh man.
Well, I'd say about a month ago, I come home from work, and my daughters and wife say, "Can you go pick up something to eat at Subway?" Jackie says, that's my daughter, Jackie sometimes, 6 years old, going on seven, says, "Will you go to Subway?" And they guess they have some sort of chicken nuggets or chicken tenders now. And I'm like, "Are you sure? It doesn't sound like Subway." But anyways, I'm like, okay, so I get to Subway. Order my subs and say, "You know, I also need some chicken tenders. I heard you guys had like chicken nuggets or chicken tenders." And she's like, "No, we don't have that." Yeah. Okay, stop. A couple weeks go by. A couple days ago, my wife heads over to Subway to get some dinner and some subs. And she gets our subs and orders Jackie's subs. And while she's doing it, she's like, "Okay, I just need a plain bun toasted with just cheese and turkey on it, nothing else. I don't know." And she went on to explain how, you know, her six-year-old daughter doesn't eat normally. And the girl goes, "Well, that's okay. That's all the time. As a matter of fact, a couple weeks ago, some guy was in here asking for chicken nuggets. I was like, what do you think this is, McDonald's?"
That was
and she was thinking, "That's my husband." And I put him up to it.
Wow.
Isn't that weird?
That is crazy.
Yeah, that is weird. And the other weird thing, since I was talking about my daughter, that I don't know how weird it is, but we were at a Meals the other night, and they served us our sodas, but they had like a carbonation issue. You know what I mean?
That happens, yeah, sure.
Yeah, it
happens. Mix was off.
Right, it was at the end or something. Anyways, you could tell they were bad. Waitress comes back, and I say, "I'm sorry, I think the carbonation's bad in these sodas." And she's like, "Oh, I'm sorry." And she goes away, and my daughter goes, "Dad, why do you got to make her feel bad?"
Oh, man.
So the waitress comes back. I said, "Thanks. Can you please tell my daughter thinks that we made you feel bad by having these drinks go back?" And the waitress was like, you know, "Holy phone calls.
What's going on?"
With the headphones on, it's weird. You don't know where it's coming from. But I do know where it's coming from because it's my phone and I left it there. You like my ringtone?
No.
Yeah.
It's still going because you're not answering it.
The only thing Olympic-wise that I wanted to really talk about tonight was the fact that in women's Olympic weightlifting, they have an event called the snatch.
Yeah, they do.
Which is pretty funny when you hear the announcer say, "Oh, look at the high snatch on the South Korean."
Yeah. Yep, I'm really disappointed in the fact that beach volleyball are wearing long pants.
It's been cool over there. It's been
bullshit.
Cool in the evenings.
Last night was the first time I got to see a little skin.
A little high snatch. I don't know if anybody else, maybe this won't be a spoiler because it was broadcast already. I watched it. The women's soccer team today, was the game against Canada was unbelievable. It was 3-3.
And U.S. almost lost?
No, well, let me finish the story. It was 3-3 in the 120th minute. They went two overtimes, two extra periods. Now listen to me, and we won on a header from Abby Wambach to it was a cross from Abby Wambach to Alex Morgan, who headed it in like the 119th minute or some shit like that. It was unbelievable. It was a great game. Canada, whatever her name is, this one girl scored 3 goals. I believe, what's her name there? Megan Rapinoe scored 2 for us. Abby Wambach scored 1. And Alex Morgan scored the old header to win it. It was awesome.
She's hot, too.
Alex Morgan is a beautiful girl. Beautiful. You're right. My wife commented as much. Yeah, I know she does.
You know who called? It was Tiny Danger.
Really? I knew you should have answered.
He texted me, said, what time are we coming? Or what time are we doing this? But little do you know, he started at 1. I just texted him and said, come on up. So.
Oh, nice. Maybe he'll show up.
Maybe he will. I didn't know he was legitimately interested. Actually, Taco I just didn't think about it at all, right. Really. But.
And then, furthermore, just before I came here, the men's basketball game finished, and we dominated Argentina.
There was some ball hitting, and Coach K getting mad.
Carmelo got smacked in the junk.
Yep. In the dick, huh?
Yep.
No, the junk.
Junk. I don't know
it's
if it was.
Area slightly below the dick.
Yeah, it's like the whole thing. This whole business is
in his yam sack.
Yeah, right.
Right.
But that was a close game at the half, and then they just blew him out.
Yeah, Argentina has some NBA players on there, you know.
Manu Ginobili, they blew out their junk. In the end, we killed them. It was awesome.
Got some news items, but
not Olympic sports news.
No
other
that,
news.
That should be the end of the Olympics. You know, I mean, it's everywhere. Everywhere you go,
it's exciting.
I like watching it, but I'm sick of all I hear about is Michael Phelps.
Yeah, who cares about Michael Phelps?
I mean, yeah, I mean, it's over now. Let's not talk about it. Let's talk about the paraplegic with the running in the sprints.
That's over now, too, though.
Yeah, that's over, too.
I don't unless he's in a relay. I don't think he's in a relay, but he might be.
Did you catch what the commentator called him, though?
She called him a bionic kangaroo. Yeah. That's right. She called him some sort of bionic kangaroo.
Those things aren't bionic. There's nothing bionic about them. They're just metal. There's no bionics. Bionics would mean it was powered or artificially, propelled.
That lady's a moron. What's her name? The one that does all the, she does all like the little interest stories.
Yeah, I know. She's a former athlete. She's got a little crooked mouth.
Yeah.
The black lady?
No.
Nope.
I can't think of her name.
I was sitting with a.
Yeah, the light black lady.
No.
She's not light black. She's a light black.
The mocha chick.
I actually think she's probably of Italian heritage.
Yep.
Sicilian. Yeah, like I can't remember her name.
Tough to say. Anyway, she's a moron. And she called that guy a bionic kangaroo. Which is dumb. Those things are just like spring steel.
Not bionics, like the bionic man. When he opened up his arm, there was electronics in there.
Right. He's not a robot, this guy.
No, not at all. He's just got...
He's not like a Mars rover. You couldn't drop him on Mars and have him send back rock samples. No. He would just run around and probably burn up.
He doesn't have billions of dollars. So.
No, he couldn't get up there. Not since you cut the space program.
Well, speaking of morons, I do have some great news items tonight, but before we get into that...
Man drink like that and he don't eat. He is going to die.
We save hard drinks in here for men who want to get drunk fast.
Bet, babe, slide a piece of the pole to the side, run the job.
Look at here.
Just playing the organ there. Did you see that?
I did. That's why the camera switched over. It's pretty sweet. Dandy, what are you drinking tonight?
Vitamin water.
Hmm. What's the flavor?
Red. Dragon fruit.
Red.
Oh, dragon fruit.
Everybody.
The power C.
Of course it is. Saucy Joe, what do you got tonight?
I'm drinking a Saranac Pale Ale.
And I, Tony Sometimes.
What are you drinking?
I'm drinking a medium coffee from Dunkin' Donuts, cream, and 1 sugar.
Inside, run the job.
Look at here.
Man drink like that and he don't eat.
He is going to die.
Tons of action in the chat room tonight. We got Mello's Junk. We got Shimbashi. We got Prince of Fort Pierce. We got Sandusky Daycare. Are you kidding me?
I think they're all one person.
No, that's actually 4 distinct people that I can think of.
Something smells in here.
Like what?
I don't know.
The smell like?
We got to turn off the air conditioner. We got an air conditioner up here, everybody, but We do have to turn it off during the show, otherwise there'd be this background noise. But a lot cooler. Although now that it's been off for about a half an hour, it's starting to warm up again. It's not even that hot out. Oh, well.
No, it's pleasant today. Outside.
Nice. Yeah, very pleasant day.
It's real nice.
If every day was like this, it would be great. We'd be in San Diego.
San Diego. I don't smell that, Danny. I don't smell anything.
I don't smell anything either.
I'm only catching it like...
once in a while.
Yeah.
It could be coming from outside.
Could be coming from you. Somewhere on you.
Kind of smells like an air conditioner, like you said.
Well, that, I got a simple explanation for that.
Dateline, Derby, Vermont. A man driving a farm tractor ran over eight vehicles in the parking lot of a Vermont police station, and those were police vehicles, in an apparent revenge scheme. Police said Roger Peon, 34, of Newport, Vermont, flattened seven marked police cruisers and one unmarked personnel vehicle at the Orleans County Sheriff's Department in Derby, Vermont, around 12:40 p.m. Thursday. And this is what Chief Deputy Philip Brooks of the Orleans County Sheriff's Department told WCAX. We came out, and sure enough, there was someone who had run over our cruisers with a tractor.
Sure enough.
Yeah, sure enough.
Just as we expected.
Yeah, they were crushed. We're going to have to get the jaws of life up here to pry the trunks open and see about the rifles and shotguns. Boy. With the vehicles crushed, police had no way to pursue Peon after he drove off in the tractor.
That's the best. The perfect crime.
Can you imagine him driving off in the tractor at about 50 miles an hour and
there's 20 cops behind him shaking their fists?
that's why I chose
Damn you, Peon.
That's the main reason I picked this story, because I that image.
Speaking of tractors, tomorrow's going to fucking, I'm going to hate life.
Empire Farm Day.
Is it Farm Day starting?
You don't got to go to that side of town.
Talking about it. I gotta cross the traffic to get to my house.
This guy lives right there.
Yeah, but what you'll do is go straight across the bridge over the canal on Bridge Street, yep, and then up on Fall Street, and you'll be there and work in no time.
No, I'm not worried. I'm worried about coming home when they're leaving farm days,
right?
Because them assholes will not let me in, even though all I want to do is take a left and go past them. I don't want to get in front of them.
You better watch what you say. You might come home and have your car crushed.
No, I
by one of those tractors.
I got a carport.
We'll crush the carport.
Oh, this tractor would crush it. It was a big tractor. I saw a picture.
See some of the freaking combines they got there?
I got double wall studs on that.
Oh, well, that'll do it. You're right. You're right. Touche.
It felt like I was in a Monster Jam rally or something. I just couldn't believe it. He's backing up, going over it, turns around, makes his way to the other vehicle, smashes those up, did his business, and headed right down Route 5.
That's a sweet move.
By did his business, they mean pissed?
No, I think they just mean the business was crushing these police cars. Right. They eventually caught up with them, the police, a mile and a half from the police station. Can you imagine that?
You never heard of that Megadeth album? Crushing police cars with my tractor is my business, and business is good?
I used to have Peace Sells, but who's buying?
Right. They have clever album titles. I don't know.
And gruesome artwork. Yeah, the damage is estimated to be about $250,000. At least two deputies had gone inside a few minutes before after washing their vehicles.
They just got them all washed up and sparkly, walked inside, probably cracked open a nice cold soda,
yep,
sat down. Next thing you know, he's out there just as they expected. Yep. Wouldn't you know
sure
it?
Sure enough.
Sure enough. Crushing him with his tractor.
Don't they have fucking cameras outside the police station?
Like in Derby, Vermont?
Like
I don't know.
Police station? And in Derby, Vermont, how many police cruisers do they really have in their parking lot?
I don't know. How many did he crush again? Does that say? They give a report?
Eight.
We don't even have eight.
Well, the funny thing is, in Derby, Vermont, that was only half the fleet.
What?
And yeah, the other half was out on patrol.
Let's check out how apparently, big Derby, Vermont is.
Apparently they should
Google the population of Derby, Vermont.
They should have been patrolling a little closer to home. They would have caught the guy with a tractor crushing their fleet.
Yeah, coming right through downtown.
Yeah, and then driving away. It was the same guy they arrested on marijuana and resisting arrest charges earlier. So
was he growing marijuana?
Possession. Marijuana
was
possession.
Just possession.
The other great thing about this article is when whoever wrote it.
Oh, it's right there.
What's the population?
Oh, you bitch.
That's the
population. Population in July 2009 was 4,828 people.
It's less than here.
And they have 16 patrol cars?
Orleans County sheriffs.
Oh, all right. That's a sheriff.
So
that makes more sense. So look up the population of Orleans County, Vermont. Now we're talking.
This is like my favorite part of the article too. It's just the end. It's not known where Peon got the tractor, but police said he comes from a farm family. So, mystery solved.
Yeah, pretty good chance that he got it from his family.
From the family farm, yeah. Yeah, that's great
stuff.
The
old Peon family.
Orleans County, New York?
Nope.
No,
Vermont.
Yes, I know.
Orleans Parish, Louisiana.
27,301.
27,000. That's a pretty good number.
27,173.
Oh, 27,000.
Its area is 721 square miles.
16 cars. Not anymore. Now they have 8.
It's one of the 4 northernmost counties in the U.S. state of Vermont. It borders Canada.
Yeah, that's border Canada. I left that part out because I didn't think it was that important.
Well, Dandy reported it. He's
well, you know that
guy.
The guy that ran over the cars wasn't Canadian. Canadians are too nice.
Right. Poor Canada, the losers of today's women's soccer match. They will not go on to face Japan like we will.
Nope. Japan will beat us at the last Olympics. But again, too much Olympics.
No, never enough.
We can get that type of discussion pretty much anywhere else in the world right now. Except for
in the chat room.
E-channel.
In the chat room, Mellow's Junk said Gina just pulled a bat out of the dryer. It was a melted bat. They were going to call your father for some expertise.
Oh, he called me about that bat.
Did he?
Yeah, he said there was a bat in the basement.
And now they found it in the dryer?
Yeah.
Oh, that means they picked it up in some laundry and threw it in the dryer.
Yeah.
Probably.
Or now it's like,
oh, you better wash your hand, Mellow's Junk.
Yeah, definitely.
Rabies.
He told me he was going to call your father. Come take care of that bat. That's what he said when he called. I had a good laugh.
He would have been there with fishing nets.
It came in through the vent. Who the hell's Caroline?
There's a Caroline in the chat room?
Caroline in the vent.
Caroline Delafave.
Came in the vent.
Huh.
2 L's, by the way.
Yeah, a lot of action in that chat room. Remember, you can log on by clicking on chat while you watch. Dateline, Lakeland, Florida.
Florida.
Preacher Todd Bentley may think he has a cure for what ails you, and it's a swift kick in the face. You guys ever hear this guy?
Sounds reasonable. I'm not going to lie.
Preacher Todd Bentley?
Nope.
Is he related to Scott Bernstein?
No,
but they should get together. The tattooed leader of Fresh Fire Ministries based in Lakeland, Florida, plans on touring the UK this month, but several citizens are begging officials to ban Bentley from the country, citing the preacher's violent healing tactics. In one interview, Bentley claims that the Holy Spirit told him to kick an elderly woman in the face with his biker boot. Just as my boot made contact with her nose, she fell under the power of God. And I got a video segment where the preacher claims he cured a man of both cancer and a broken sternum by, you guessed it, socking him in the chest. So
the guy had a broken sternum and he punched him in the chest to cure it?
Well, I'll let Scott Bentley explain how it went.
That goes against all modern.
His name's not Scott Bentley.
Oh, it's Todd Bentley.
You're thinking of Scott Bernstein.
Yeah.
Todd
Bentley. Confused now. Some superhuman being named Scott Bentley.
He didn't come for the service. He was at the hotel here.
Mm-hmm.
And he heard me give this word. Yeah. I'm going to pray for anybody that has cancer right now. And I didn't realize he was in a truck accident. And he broke his sternum, and he had several broken ribs. The Lord didn't tell me this. All I knew is going to pray for somebody.
Works in mysterious ways.
We're going to bind the strong man. This man's healing would be the first sign of a brand new anointing over death and infirmity and cancer. That's what the Lord told me. Huh. So when he finally came up onto the platform and I was going to go pray for him, the Lord spoke to me, and I know it was the Lord, and it's got to be the Lord. You only do this when it's the Lord.
Don't try this at home unless it's the Lord.
The Lord. Yeah, there's got to be a don't try this at home. The Lord told me, and remember, I didn't know he had a broken sternum or broken ribs. The Lord said, I want you to punch him in the sternum as hard as you can. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, restoration, Rick's here, my first service, God, you want me to punch this guy? And it just didn't make sense to me. And I thought, Lord, he's dying. You know, he lost over 40 pounds.
So anyways, I
punched him in that broken sternum, and he ended up on the ground and just vibrating under the power of God. He gets up, and immediately you can see a
seizure
in his face, in his countenance. And long story short, he was totally healed of cancer. The broken sternum was healed. The ribs were healed.
Instantly.
Instantly.
With the punch.
With
he
the
got
punch.
Healed. It didn't hurt him.
Wow.
Let me tell you what, that motherfucker ever punched me in my chest, I had a broken sternum. I'd judo chop his trachea until he turned blue in the face.
Oh my gosh. Look who it is. Friend of the show.
Oh shit.
Is it Tiny Danger?
Tiny Danger.
Oh boy, how about it? Have a seat right there on the couch, Danger.
Yeah, we'll get you a table. We'll get you situated.
Side. Yeah, have a seat.
Sit closest to Tony and we'll get you situated here. I'll get up and situate you.
So I apologize. I should have given you a call, let you know that we were doing this tonight. But when you texted me, the show had already started.
No, it's all good. Thanks.
He's back.
I'm going to be a little quiet tonight.
All right. That's cool. Oh, you know what we need?
What?
Is that.
What?
That cam.
Oh, I can move that. No, don't come in here and start.
A little lower. Oh, you can see. I got you.
That.
And there you go. Tiny Danger, everybody. The star of last week's episode 63.
He's our resident healer, right?
He is?
Yeah.
Healer.
Like that dude we
just
saw.
Like he can kick me in the chest right now?
Yeah,
oh,
yeah. He kicked you in your junk right now.
Talking about
lose weight?
Yeah, he came in right after we viewed that Todd Bentley video. A guy named Todd Bentley. He's a preacher who cures people by beating them.
Punched a dude in the chest. He had a broken sternum.
And cancer. And after he punched him, both ailments were cured.
Can you believe that?
No.
No, I can't.
I wonder if he kicked me in the balls if my hair would grow back.
Your ball hair?
No, the hair on
your
fucking head.
Oh, head hair. Maybe. Maybe
I can kick you. Let's email this guy.
Seems like he would need to kick you in the head.
Sounds like a busy guy.
Why would you want to get kicked in the junk just to make your hair grow back in your head?
I don't know.
This guy works on location. Punch in the head, things for the head.
I'll let him punch me in the head. I got a hard head.
I'll let him punch you in the head, too.
I'm going to hit him back, though.
Well, I don't think that's how he works.
So anyways, here's this guy. He, and this is the thing. You know, I have a lot of stories of craziness out there to choose from, you know, and there's always a reason I choose these. And it wasn't just because this guy beats people to heaven. In 2009, Bentley left his wife, Shona, for Jesse Hasbrook, a church intern with who he had an affair. And the reason I put that in there is if there's a guy who says he talks to the Lord,
yep.
And you're not gonna sin. I mean, if the Lord talks to me, I'll never sin again. I promise you that. And I'll go to church 7 days a week if the Lord talked to me.
What do you think he would say to you?
Tony, sometimes. Go to church. Punch Dandy Aaron D in the ball sack.
Tell him his hair will grow back.
And cure him of his testicular cancer.
Right.
No, I don't. I just think it's bullshit. And I think when a guy like this does something like that, here's his story. He was a freaking loser.
Scott Bentley. He's a charlatan.
Well, he was probably a freaking loser kind of growing up, and, you know, you could tell by the thing that he a little overweight and
not the most attractive guy.
And then he acquires some power and some wealth. And now all of a sudden, church interns are interested in him, and there he goes, you know. It's like the first time he had to get some, you know, some sweet loving.
Some
intern loving.
Are you saying that he was the pastor of that church and then the intern affair happened? Or you don't know the chronology?
Yeah, no, it happened in 2009. He formed this church back in, at age 15, he was convicted of sexual assaulting a 7-year-old too, by the way, which should be noted.
Oh my God.
So he
was probably trying to cure her of something.
Hmm. Yeah, so it's ridiculous. This guy, you know, these guys.
I'm going to be
they're total
completely
frauds.
Obvious. I don't really feel comfortable talking about this. I don't.
About religion?
Whatever you guys got going on.
He doesn't feel comfortable with whatever comfortable. We're talking about. The next topic, not comfortable with that either, probably. See what happens. Thanks for coming.
Just the deal is this guy who has hundreds of thousands of followers, well, man, I don't know, 400,000 people attended his latest
really?
Revival over a 2-month period.
Really?
Yeah, over a 2-month period.
I got to tell you what, that's the way to do it. Start a church.
Yeah, why not? It doesn't matter what you did. You can always say that you're asking for the Lord's forgiveness.
Yeah.
And you're going to go scot-free.
Next topic.
And if you don't go scot-free, you're going to go Scott Bernstein.
He's giving free seminars in Ovid first weekend in September.
Oh, this is a local guy?
In Ovid, New York?
Florida.
Scott Bernstein is?
Scott Bernstein.
Get out of town, dandy.
Then he would be called an Ovidian.
Yeah. A branch Ovidian. That you're lying.
I am, but okay. It would be fucking that hilarious, would be, wouldn't it?
Like, if he had to go to Ovid, that would be funny, yeah.
Here's South Seneca High School.
Right.
Here's a lighter-hearted piece of news.
This one's for you, Tiny.
And I chose this one just because I think the image of it is funny, but I think it's kind of ridiculous. Dateline, Wiltshire, Great Britain. Beer-drinking horses enjoy some cold ones. Vacations are a time to relax, and what better way to get in the mood than with a tasty beer? That's the treat that Monty, Max, and Prince, three brewery horses in Wiltshire, Great Britain, enjoyed before going off on their annual two-week vacation.
What? A horse vacation?
Yeah.
Let's hear about that.
They are among the last remaining working shires working in the UK brewing industry.
That's awesome.
They deliver beer to pubs around Wadworth.
Cask beer.
Or in Devizes, Wiltshire.
It's awesome.
But every August, the horses get a chance to spend 2 weeks away from the man, romping in the fields, chewing on some grass, and doing other horse-like activities. But before the horses go off on their own, they are traditionally each given a pint or two to enjoy before being led down the main road into a field where they are expected to show their delight at being set free, the Wiltshire Times reported.
And that's where the saying, horsing one down, comes from.
I guess so.
I just said that. I don't know if it's true.
The horse that won the Kentucky Derby last year used to get one Guinness a day from his trainer.
A day?
Yeah. For strength.
Huh. For the strength?
For strength.
It's got good head.
That's the famous Guinness.
But did he mind his own P's and Q's?
I don't know. I don't know.
Did he mind his own P's and Q's?
I don't think
pints
he did.
Pints and quarts.
Is that a horse-like thing to do? Is that true?
I don't know.
Is that true?
No, it's not.
Oh, nice.
Tiny Danger.
I love that we're spreading misinformation again. Horsing one down and P's and Q's for you folks out there.
Okay.
If anybody didn't notice, I have the same outfit I had on.
I pointed that out to Joe. Danny pointed it out to me right when you walked in.
Well,
I was on the SaucePod webpage for some reason, and I look, and I was like, oh, man, that's already up. And I look, and I'm like, nope, that's last week.
How do you like the quad?
Look at that, quad vision.
Didn't think we were going to need it tonight, Danger.
I'm looking right at you.
Thanks for filling our fourth box.
That was a pleasure. It was a pleasure. Last week was something that I couldn't even imagine.
You can't shake it. You can't get it out of your head.
Were you disgusted at the amount of tacos they were eating?
I don't know.
We were most impressed with Tugboat Scotty's meticulous, methodical approach.
You guys were both very impressed with his methodical approach.
That's true.
Is he a big kid?
I played golf tonight.
Yeah, he's tall and thin. Basketball player.
I played golf tonight with Bill Majors, and he was looking forward to another challenge.
Like the next challenge or more taco-eating challenges?
The taco-eating. another eating challenge.
Well, the thing is that I think Billy and Walters especially came in a little overconfident.
That's Johnny Wawa.
And Johnny Wawa came in a little overconfident.
I heard he was
drinking beers. Well, he was drinking like pounded beers before, like, you know what I mean?
But that's how he is. It's not like
that's what he said. I know, but you know,
it's not like how he is. It's just that everybody's having a good time and they're going to have some beers. But that's actually your take a step back in an eating challenge.
Right, you got to set that aside. Center yourself. Get focused like Tugboat Scotty did.
Yeah. And you know,
get some water, sip it slowly.
While he was sitting there doing his thing meticulously and methodically, you know, he knew what was going on. He was playing strategy. He saw the guys next to him. He stayed a step ahead. Once it got into the 20s, he stayed a step ahead of the people behind him. And then when he got to 31, he didn't need to take any more steps.
And yet he's going to be a doctor, so I mean, nothing against the other guys, but, I mean, you know, it is what it is.
What did the winner win?
Absolutely
nothing.
Nothing.
That's the crazy thing about it.
Absolutely nothing. They played for nothing.
That's perfect.
The person that gets
did
random.
Did they have to pay for their tacos, too?
No, no.
Another, yeah, who did another, pay for that? Another interesting
I think it
story.
Was our host at Red's Place put up the tacos for the contest. They had a big night, too, I think, there. I think it was a win-win for everybody involved, except yeah. for the Walters and Majors and the winner, actually.
Well, actually, I did hear that every single participant did puke.
Yes. Yeah, and you heard
correct. True. You heard correct on that.
And Scotty was fighting it, and Bill Major said, just go do it. Well, you'll feel so much better.
Oh, that hurts so bad coming up, though, all that fucking... Ugh.
Yeah, I mean, they're not spicy, but...
31 tacos, one at a time.
But a lot round. Of people have been saying that us four should have a cigarette smoking contest.
How would you do that?
Oh, I'd fucking win.
You just got to horse them down?
As
one
many
after
as
another?
In an hour.
As many as you can get in an hour. Well, that's tough.
Yeah, that's despicable.
You're asking, yeah. You're asking a lot.
That's the right word for that. It is despicable. You're asking to be sick.
Hey, Dan, do you got any listener mail this week?
No. I actually did that one
no?
time as a young boy.
Well, just that Tampa Bay.
Smoked a lot of cigarettes real quick. Got sick.
Should we cue it up?
No, it's okay. Just the Tampa Bay podcast. The Tampons want us to be their friend on Twitter again.
No way. Those guys are our nemesis podcast.
What kind of name is that for your podcast?
Yeah. Nah, it's like a... It's not... They call themselves the Tampons.
I know it.
It's not the name of
that's their crew, the Tampons. We got to think of a rowdy name.
Next time I hear from somebody that comes from Tampa Bay, I'm going to be like, oh, you're a fucking tampon, huh?
Yeah, exactly.
It's really. I don't know. That might not go over so well for you.
Depends on who it is.
Maybe they're a fan of that show.
Yeah. What if it was Warren Sapp?
Yeah, you probably get
I can run faster than that fat bastard.
Danny's got an answer for every threat.
Yeah.
You know, he's always
he's fearless.
You know, who was the one guy that he said he was the ridge a few weeks ago? I mean, this was a guy not to be messed with.
Scott, well, Bernstein.
Scott Bernstein was one, but he also planned on taking over another guy. I think it was a guy on bath salts, maybe.
Forget about that.
I want to try bath salts.
Someone else said that, and I'm not even kidding you. Someone else said that to me the other day, and I'm going to think who it is.
If somebody was there to watch, like, was in the room and would watch, like, have watch them, me.
You, let you watch eat you them? Eat them?
I'm not going to fucking eat anybody.
You don't know that. No one goes them? Into taking bath salts thinking, I'm not going to eat anybody or I'm going to eat somebody.
I'd actually like to know, do you eat the bath salts? Like,
no, it's a knockoff. It's a knockoff cocaine, so I imagine
I think you snort it.
Or shove it in your ass.
And, like, what if you wanted to shower with them? They're bath salts, right?
No.
You can't shower with them?
You could, but that's not their purpose.
What is the purpose?
It's like a code name. Bath salts is a code name for bad drugs.
It's like a synthetic.
It's like Maui Waui, you know?
Because technically the stuff that is in it that gets you high was, in some cases still is, I guess, sold in products that are Bath, Bed and Beyond, stuff, places like that. That's correct, right? I'm correct in stating that.
I don't know that that's true. I don't know that that's true at all. No, it's just a synthetic drug that they... Name bath salts, I assume, because it looks like bath salts, the commercial product that you would use in your tub.
I was thinking that maybe it was more like some products that were in bath salts.
I know, and it's a very confusing thing, and I wish that like a law enforcement official or someone like Scott Bernstein would clarify that for us, because it's really confusing. But
and can I ask who Scott Bernstein is?
You can ask, but.
Episode 62, we met a guy named Scott Bernstein who helped apprehend a perp using the old "You're in a movie starring with Jennifer Aniston."
He's not a bounty hunter.
He's a fugitive recovery agent.
An FRA
bounty hunter. Another word for bounty hunter. Yeah. But he's apprehended so many perps, it's unbelievable.
But usually he does it by concocting some sort of clever ruse, like he did with this guy in Hawaii.
Told him that he was in a movie starring with Jennifer Aniston. He was going to be given a spot in a movie with Jennifer Aniston because I guess the guy has some type of actor.
So and the guy flew home.
And then they apprehended that perp.
Tricked
at
him.
The airport.
Scott Bernstein style.
Yep. Yeah. Came right up onto the old airplane, too.
He's like a real name?
Yeah. Oh, he's a real guy. He's got a real website, and he's got real pictures of him with Hawaiian leis. And
He's a knockoff Dog the Bounty Hunter.
Scott Bernstein is not affiliated with the Bernstein Bears.
And he likes to hire women. because they can trick people better.
Huh. Scott Bernstein's no dummy. Dateline Scotland.
That's named after Scott Bernstein, by the way.
He conquered that land and they named it Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Scotland.
Teacher says he killed a girl is an excuse for missing work. There's faking sick and then there's telling your employers that you just killed a small child. 42-year-old teacher Derek McClone was well known at Calderhead High School in Scotland for making up stories to get out of work. In an August 1st hearing of the General Teaching Council of Scotland, McClone admitted to lying on a number of occasions. In his most egregious fabrication, the music teacher told school officials that he had just run over a little girl with his car. On another occasion, he called from his home in Glasgow, claiming he was stuck in a volcanic ash cloud in Iceland.
This guy's a real character.
And then, apparently, on his Facebook page, he went on a drunken rant, admitting to the council panel that he referred to his co-workers as bitches and wrote that he would hunt them down, according to the Scottish Sun, which is a fine publication. If you're looking for Scottish news.
So how do you make out?
I can give no reasonable explanation for my actions, he told the council.
Bad salts.
That's basically saying, I can't explain what I did, but I did it. Let me back and be a teacher.
I didn't actually run over a girl, but I said I did. I wasn't actually trapped in a volcanic ash cloud, but I said I did. And I can't explain why.
I have no reasonable explanation.
For my actions.
Yeah, he says the hearing panel concluded that his behavior falls short of the standards expected of a registered teacher.
That stands to reason, yeah. Sorry, pal.
I got a question.
Sure, shoot.
This is a news story. What the fuck's going on at Chick-fil-A?
The Chick-fil-A owner came out and said that he doesn't want to hire gays and lesbians because he's... much like Todd Bentley, believes that the Lord says that it's wrong, that marriage is an institution between a man and a woman and not a man and a man or a woman and a woman. So, as a show of support, more like-minded people, mostly from the conservative right wing of America, have tremendous voting clout, went to Chick-fil-A in droves. And ordered chickens, just went there. They just hammered it.
You know what pisses me off more about Chick-fil-A than that? It's they're closed on fucking Sundays.
Well, there's no Chick-fil-A around here.
Yeah, but still, when you go on vacation and you're coming home on Sunday and you just want to stop at Chick-fil-A for that one last.
The Lord says that you shall not work on
it's a day of rest. It's a Sabbath.
I've never seen a Chick-fil-A.
No? They're so good.
When I was in North Carolina, for a very short time, I don't know if you want to say dated, but when I was down there, I kind of hooked up with her and hung out with her for a while, and she worked at a Chick-fil-A. That was a long time ago.
It's so good.
And more working.
I like Bojangles better.
Where is the nearest Chick-fil-A?
I don't think there's many in New York State even.
I think there might be one in Rochester.
Is there one? I don't know. There's a southern thing. It's kind of like Bojangles. Yeah. I don't know if you guys ever ate Bojangles, but that was some really good chicken and
biscuits. Well, I know Mr. Bojangles.
Yeah. But, but that's what's going on at Chick-fil-A, Dandy.
Bojangles wholeheartedly supports homosexual relations. I'm going to come right out and say that.
The nearest one is in Scranton, Pennsylvania.
Scranton.
According to the chat room.
That's not Rochester at all.
Good point.
I'm just saying. Just a lot further.
Talking to myself and knows where it is.
They don't support that, and that's what's going on with them. Then they were supposedly building a location in somewhere in Boston, and the mayor of Boston wrote them a letter and said, "You're not going to build in my city, goddammit," with an attitude like that.
Did he say goddammit?
No, he actually was very eloquent in his letter. I'm just paraphrasing.
It's freaking crap. It's crap. For a mayor of any city to tell any restaurant owner that he can't build in there because of his religious views is ridiculous. It's just as ridiculous as New York City saying you can't build a mosque, four blocks away from 9/11. But it's not even a mosque. It's a community center. regardless is, yeah, I mean, furthermore, the mayor of Boston, I think Rahm Emanuel in Chicago said it too.
Yeah.
It's so ridiculous.
I mean, yeah, but no one, even if you point out that side, and several people have pointed out that side, no one cares.
I mean, why would they care? It's only in the, let's see, where is it in our list of constitutional amendments? Oh, it's number one.
Yeah, nobody, if you point out that someone's being hypocritical, they're not going to listen to you.
It's just ridiculous.
There's a 0% chance of affecting someone with a hypocrisy argument. They just don't care. No one cares. They're right. Everyone's right. How could they not be? I'm right. You're right. Both sides of our argument, we're both right.
And I'm not. I personally, I support gay marriage, but I don't support a mayor telling a business owner who owns a business and doesn't support gay marriage that he can't build in his city because he doesn't support gay marriage. I mean, it's
hard to say. You have to go and say, do the majority of the constituents, that if they support it, then okay. If not, then he's just a instrument.
It's Bush League, really.
It's crazy.
Dandy, that's the type of shit I'd like to fix instead of going to Mars. If we could fix that type of
thing. So you can't throw, that's something you can't throw money at. It's not going to fix it. You can't fix it with money. And that's the kind of shit Dandy was talking about.
Actually, and you could fix it with a little education. Educate that fucking mayor.
What kind of education? Educate the mayor?
Yeah.
Yeah, that'll probably fix it.
The thing is, it's a double standard. The political view in Boston or Chicago is to support gay marriage. So they're getting an opportunity here to say, oh, I'm a big supporter of gay marriage. I didn't want them to build a Chick-fil-A in our...
And that becomes a national thing. Like, that guy is now known nationally for doing that.
In my mind, for being a douchebag. But in many other minds, for being a hero. A hero of the gays and lesbians. And many people, knee-jerk reaction will be, gee, Tony sometimes is against gays and lesbians. It's totally not the case. I'm for the ideals that our country was built on. And the laws that we passed, that our founding fathers passed, we disregard them anymore. It's not like, the head of the business council said this. It was the mayor, the democratically elected mayor of Boston, who says this, which is totally against the oath he took when upon entering office. Again, here we go. We getting a little political tonight. And it's
talking to myself says, put all the Chick-fil-A's and gays on Mars.
great solution. That would cost a lot of money.
I would like to say that I'm actually the mayor of the gay community.
You are?
Honestly, yeah.
Right. How do you feel about Chick-fil-A?
Well, I just think that, marriage is an institute, right?
Sure.
An institute of technology is like RIT. Yep.
So why shouldn't they be as miserable as every other couple?
I was
going
to say,
couple?
If gay people want to be miserable, let them get married. Who cares?
Right.
Yeah, and then the other thing is that people will say, now that we're going to be getting into the talk about gay marriage, people will say, we just can't let gays and lesbians get married. Pretty soon there'll be no regular marriages and everybody will be gay. All the gays will take over. But that's logically doesn't make sense because gays and lesbians can't reproduce. No. So...
And they make up a minority, such a small minority.
I know, it is. It is.
Logically, it just doesn't hold.
This is crazy.
Gays
talk.
And lesbians can reproduce.
This is crazy.
They cannot
talk.
Reproduce.
Not with each other, but they can reproduce.
Well, yeah, not within a marriage.
As I understand it, the science of it is that they will not necessarily reproduce gay offspring, no matter what they do. It doesn't guarantee that their offspring are going to be gay.
I bet you more than half of the time, if a gay couple had a child, that child's not going to be gay.
I bet you're
more
right.
than half the time.
Yeah, it would go on the same percentage of any other child
exactly
born
right. You're
in
100%
America.
Correct
probably
on that.
1 in 20?
Woo-hoo. Guys, this is freaking crazy. Tiny Danger's here to say this is a crazy conversation. Honestly.
As the mayor of the gay community, this is a crazy conversation.
What are we talking about? We're not talking about this anymore.
What do you want to talk about?
All right, fair enough.
What do you got on the agenda?
Shut it down.
I'd like to talk about 2012 fantasy football.
That's always a sweet topic in here.
If you had the first pick of the draft, 2012.
Jeez, I'm so far out of touch, I don't even know what I'd say, but I would probably go with a quarterback. I would probably go with... Jeez, actually, that's tough, man. That's tough this year. There's no clear-cut number one,
first
is there?
First pick.
Who's the best running back?
Aaron Rodgers.
Oh, yeah. He's Aaron Rodgers is who I'd pick first, probably. I'd probably pick Aaron Rodgers in our league that Tiny Dinger's talking about. Right.
Which we need to draw the draft order for if we're going to, now that the draft date has been established.
That's true. Well, Tiny Dinger's a commissioner. That's true. Not only is he mayor of the gay and lesbian community, but he's commissioner of a local fantasy football league.
Unbelievable.
Darnell. I was a commissioner last year. Worst commissioner ever.
I could imagine.
Yeah.
Top running back would be, what would it be?
I'm not very good at fantasy football anymore because I don't know the answers to these questions, and it's August. I used to be really
good. This year it's going to be good owner. Frank Gore.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Who's the young freaking guy that the Browns took there? What's his?
Well, there's Adrian Peterson.
No, he's new. We know what I'm talking about.
Well, he's a potential number one. Yeah, I'm thinking a potential
number
one.
He totally exploded his knee last year. You're going to put trust in that?
He came back, though, didn't he?
He blew out every fucking tendon he had in his knee.
All of it.
But didn't he come back and finish the...
He's still rehabbing now.
Oh, is he? Well, like I said, that's why I'm no good at fantasy football.
I think he blew his knee out the last game of the season. I think it was the last game.
He may have.
ACL, MCL, and PCL.
Those are all the CLs.
LeGarrette Blount, number one.
No, I picked that fucking prick last year. I'm not even going to touch him this year.
I wouldn't take him. There's some action in the chat room, actually, about this.
You've opened up a can of worms.
Really?
Trent Richardson is who you're talking about.
That's what I was talking about.
Yeah, Elton John chiming in the chat room.
That's what I was talking about, Trent Richardson.
Yeah. But he hasn't even played a game yet.
No, he hasn't. I was just asking who he was. I was trying to remember his name. Hey, I remember he took a young girl to her prom. A leukemia survivor.
Did he?
Yeah, he took some young lady to her senior prom.
He's a little meatball.
Well, he seems like a nice guy. And you know that counts for everything in fantasy football.
Yeah.
If you're a nice guy.
Yep.
I'm going to take a kicker in the third.
That's why I always take Maurice Jones-Drew. He's a nice guy.
I took him like that too, and he screwed me.
This is Bush League.
He's a nice guy.
Who's your first pick, Tiny?
He's not going to tell you.
No.
Well, I like Aaron Rodgers.
Yeah, gotta like Aaron Rodgers.
But I'd like the fifth or sixth pick, and I'd probably go with. I don't know.
You brought it up. You must have had someone in mind.
AJ Green.
Larry Fitzgerald?
No.
Corey Dillon?
Corey
Dillon. The Titans running back. What's his name?
Chris Johnson?
I think he's going to bounce back.
Yeah, I think he's going to have a big year this year, too.
Listen, I'll give you guys one piece of advice. Any running back that's been in the league 5 years and has had a lot of success, you got to be wary of because they all drop off at some point. There are very few Emmitt Smiths that go into their 30s like that.
Running backs are hard now because no team has...
Well, they all have several.
Yeah, they're all using two, three, yeah.
Well, that's settled.
It's going to be the year...
Good.
It's going to be the year of the wide receiver.
You think so?
A lot of good wide receivers this year.
A lot of good wide receivers every year.
Yeah, that's because NFL teams throw the ball all over the place, but
to receivers who catch it.
Yep, and then either punch their moms or get a DWI or get suspended,
kill themselves or whatever.
Yeah. Wide receivers are a crazy bunch.
Fantasy football.
Who the hell punched their mother?
Des Bryant.
Cowboys.
Did he really?
Yeah.
Slapped his mom. Punched or slapped?
I think he punched her, didn't he?
I think he may have punched her.
I know, he actually choked her.
Okay. Oh, is that true?
It would have been more degrading if the open hand slapped her.
Though they didn't know is that he was on bath salts.
Right. He was hanging out with Michael Irvin.
That's the thing, though. Michael Irvin was an addict, so there was always hope for him. But with Dez Bryant, he is a junkie. Dez Bryant was a punk, so they don't have him.
He's not a junkie, he's a punk. Right.
What about Cam Newton?
What, did he finally learn how to read?
No, you can't take the Carolina Panthers quarterback second, first pick.
No, definitely. But he's saying if he was, it's like sixth pick, that's what you were talking about.
Do you think he's going to have another year like he had last year, though?
I think he'll be better.
I forgot about him. Ray Rice. I'm going to go with him again. And I think that the best running back of the draft is going to be LeSean McCoy.
Yeah, maybe. It's a crapshoot.
It's not a crapshoot.
It is a crapshoot.
It's not.
I mean, there's some percentages you can play, but in the end, you're just hoping your guy doesn't get hurt.
What if his knee gets blown out first play? It's a crapshoot.
Like when I picked Tom Brady with the first pick that one year in the first game of the season, he blows his fucking knee out.
Exactly.
Crapshoot.
Arian Foster.
Oh, yeah,
second series. Knee blown out.
Have a nice season with Trent Dilfer as your quarterback or whoever the fuck.
I think Matt Castle was the backup that year.
It's on. Either way, whatever you guys say or don't say, it's upon us.
Boy, this season is something this year, huh?
The season is upon us.
I think we should do a sauce pod fantasy.
We did last year. And then everybody yelled at us for talking about sports.
No, I think we should do a sauce pod league.
What, like
a couple of guys that are in the chat room?
Yeah, I have trouble keeping track of the one league I'm in, but I'm in. I don't care. I'll get my ass kicked in that league, too. I used to be a king.
Yahoo. It would take, no time at all.
I know. I just won't change my
mind. Elton John would be
in. Pick up free agents, probably.
Elton John, hold me closer, tiny dinger. seriously.
Yeah, he wrote that. Right. He wrote that.
I watched a video.
You think I came out on my own?
I watched a video today.
Is his name in reference to Hold Me Closer, Tiny Dancer?
No, Hold Me Closer, Tiny Dancer.
Well, yeah, obviously. I watched an interview with Sir Elton John today where he was berating and kind of putting down Madonna for her new record and her seeming endorsement of MDMA and party drugs, as they were, bath salts.
Wow.
Because she's trying to establish herself as an electronic music person now.
At age 60?
Right.
So do you think she allows her age 15-year-old daughter to partake?
She's 50-something, right? She's 50.
She's got to be when I was...
She was in a feud with Deadmau5, a famous electronic musician. After she...
Who does absolutely no drugs.
After she took the stage. You know this story? And obviously you do. You're the king of entertainment. Why do I even bother? She took the stage and asked if anybody had seen Molly. In reference to the drug.
She's way too old to be talking about fucking drugs.
I know. She's never taken any of those things. No. I guarantee it. I mean, she wears
that little red Kabbalah bracelet. Yeah. You think she's blowing fucking Molly up?
She walks up on stage. I'm going to say something cool that the kids will like. Has anybody seen Molly? And then Deadmau5 is like, you're a fucking chump. We've taken this music form like in 10 years so far, and now you just set us back. So Elton John was like, she should just stick to being a mediocre pop singer, not
cone-shaped tit,
not trying to change another genre.
Wow, well, you hold me closer, tiny dang.
Yeah, I mean, he's got all the clout in the world.
I didn't realize that all this was going on in the world of Madonna this week.
Yep.
I missed it. Was off my radar.
Her record is called MDNA. Her new record, Madonna. You know what I mean? Like an abbreviation, MDNA. But it's supposed to play on MDMA. Drug, ecstasy, Molly.
And would you like to go to like a rave? Hear what they call it?
Would I like to?
Yeah,
I've been before, but this was like way, you know, this was in '97 or whatever when it was it was lame.
I got lost at a rave for like 6 hours.
I got a headache, just the pressure of the noise.
And people are scary at raves.
All the time.
People all dressed up like fucking wizards
and glowing,
goblins.
And glowing at you.
Freaks you right the fuck out.
Yeah, waving things at you. I wasn't
I was always like, get a friggin' job.
That's you went in there just telling people to get a job.
Yeah. Honestly, I was always part of the music scene, but then at a certain point in my life, I got a job.
Yeah.
And then I had to move on. And then I went back to that same music scene, and I wasn't accepted because...
Because you were wearing Under Armour golf shirt.
A green collared shirt.
Yeah. And a Callaway golf hat.
But I'm the same person.
You're part of the establishment now.
Huh. Underneath the green collared golf shirt, you're the same person.
No question about it. That's what I don't like about any music scene.
I've known you a long time. I've seen you all kinds of different stuff. Yeah. I always know you're the same person.
I was always the same.
I know that.
Might have been lame, but I was the same.
You're the same lame that you always were, so... Mayor of the gay community.
Dateline, Florida, once again. Topless woman leads deputies on chase. Who doesn't like to drive with her top down? Florida woman Mandy Ramsey, 35, allegedly told authorities that when a deputy tried to pull her over for speeding, she did not stop because she was driving topless. The report states that when a deputy in Marion County attempted to pull over a speeding pickup truck on Saturday, the vehicle allegedly turned onto another street and sped away. The truck ran a stop sign and nicked an oak tree in the process, according to the Gainesville Sun.
And hence the crime was committed, nicking that oak tree.
The deputy lost sight of the truck, but ultimately a sheriff's helicopter located the vehicle parked behind a mobile home. Click Orlando reports. So we got multiple reports feeding into this one SaucePod report. The passenger side mirror was broken, and you guessed it, an oak leaf sitting on the remains.
That right there is incriminating evidence.
Yep. That's all. Call Scott Bernstein at that point. Actually, instead of the helicopter, they should have got Bernstein, because think about it. This woman's driving around topless, and they call in the helicopter.
Is that a crime there?
That may not have been
was
a crime.
Was that the crime?
No,
was that why they were pulling
no,
over?
No.
I missed that part.
The crime was, I don't know. She was speeding. And then she made things worse by taking off. If the officer saw she was topless, she might have got a ticket for public loot.
Indecency?
Something like that.
Yeah. Not here. You could do that here. You could speed and get pulled over and only get the speeding ticket in downtown.
I love New York. Authorities found that the truck belonged to James Woodard, who had said he had not been driving in the past 2 hours, though media sources are reporting that Woodard is Ramsey's boyfriend. Ramsey's Facebook page, where her name is listed as Mandy Ramsey Woodard, lists the two as married, although they are not.
She's full of lies, this
I know,
woman.
But why would you put that in your... That's like a crazy girlfriend.
That is a crazy girlfriend.
I guess what she said she was doing was she was going to surprise James Woodard.
By coming home in his truck topless?
Yeah, exactly.
Honey, I'm home.
And she said she didn't want to get pulled over. Officials later found Ramsey at her home swimming, according to her Facebook page, which we're getting some reports from her Facebook page now, apparently. I don't understand that. She must have posted, ha ha ha, just outran the cops, now in my pool.
Yeah. Swimming.
Something like that.
Swimming in lies.
LOL.
LOL.
JK.
Reminds me of the movie Overboard.
That does remind you of the movie Overboard?
With Kurt Russell.
Yep.
In the
that plot.
The other actress who played a mermaid.
Yeah, what's her name there?
Goldie
Hawn, exactly.
Was it Goldie Hawn?
Yeah, that's
they played that mermaid,
movie.
Or was it?
No, not yeah, that's right. That is Goldie Hawn in Overboard, but the mermaid is.
I can't think of her name.
Go to the chat room. They know. There
it's,
it is.
It's Brooke something.
Nope.
Brooke Shields.
No, it's not.
Nope. It's Swiss Family Robinson.
Nope.
Negative.
Nope. You're thinking of
Ariel?
Blue Lagoon.
Yeah, there you go.
That would be her.
Nobody's in the chat room.
What?
Helen Hunt Dog.
She's the same.
It's not Helen Hunt Dog.
It's really good. She's the same woman who played the giant. She was a giant. She grew into a giant in a movie. Remember?
Vagina.
Do you remember that movie?
Vagina movie?
Blonde-haired girl with the curly hair. She
the
was 50 a 50-foot
woman?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's the same actress. The same woman. It's the same actress that played the mermaid, I believe.
No, it's not. I don't think it is.
Come on, Dandy. Get on it over there.
Revenge of the 50-foot woman or whatever?
Put mermaid actress into the...
The name of the movie is Splash.
Yeah, there you go.
Tom Hanks, John Candy.
Yeah.
Splash right there.
What's her name?
Daryl Hannah.
Daryl Hannah. She played the 50-foot
woman. Is she the
50-foot
woman? Really?
She check Daryl out 50-foot woman too, Dandy. And then we can start getting ready to get up out of here.
Yeah, it's hotter than balls in here.
Mm-hmm. Is that air conditioner?
Attack of the 50-foot cheerleader?
No.
Nope. 50-foot woman.
Jesus, I think what year was that in?
Before Splash, I think.
Fuck.
Just look up Daryl Hannah.
I'm on her IMDb page.
Oh, perfect. Because she's not in that movie. That's why.
Not. Then I thought you said it was the same girl.
He did.
I did. That's what we want to find out. That's what we want to find out.
I think
answers.
It was like
what am I looking
the
for?
Same girl from like Barbarella. Or what's her name? I don't know. Anyway.
Did anybody see the new Batman?
There really is a movie called Attack of the 50-Foot Cheerleader that
I
came out
that.
This year.
I believe that. No, I didn't see the new Batman.
I heard it's pretty good.
I heard it was great. I didn't watch The Dark Knight either, though, yet.
So. Oh, I saw that. It was great.
I should watch it.
Allison Hayes.
Was the 50-Foot
Woman? Well, that's from 1958. The remake in 1993 was Daryl Hannah. Danny Baldwin.
There's the confusion because I'm not thinking of the 93 one.
That you were thinking of the 53 version.
There's an old movie with a huge old painted
poster.
There
might be, but obviously I didn't think that would be Daryl Hannah in the.
That's why I said it wasn't Daryl Hannah.
I was thinking of the one that came out in our lifetime.
She's straddling a expressway in the photo.
That's the original.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I don't think I've ever seen the original.
The other one is a picture of
her straddling something else.
John Candy.
John Candy. No, John Candy's not in that movie. God. When did John Candy pass away? It was a few years ago, eight to ten years ago.
In 1998 or 93, it was a TV movie.
Yeah, see, I didn't see that.
She's straddling the Berlin Wall.
This was a movie released to theaters.
No, she's straddling the Berlin Wall
with a car in her hand.
See, I didn't see that one.
And her one boob looks weird.
Oh, well, it's part of her allure.
Look at it, it's like somebody pushed it to the side. Look at it.
Another giant, an invisible giant.
Does it look like it's pushed?
It does. It looks like a torpedo. Pushed. Looks like Madonna.
Let's get out of here.
Got anything else, guys, before we wrap it up?
No.
Tiny Danger?
Hold me closer.
Darnell.
Dandy?
Nah, I'm good.
Joe?
Worst episode ever.
It could be. It's hard to tell.
They're always the worst episode ever.
That's all we make. Thanks for coming.
Well, Waterloo Man was arrested for soliciting a relationship with a 12-year-old.
14, I think, wasn't 14. It?
14. Yeah, fucking dirtball.
A lot of that going on, though.
Yeah, there's a lot of it going on for sure.
There's been a lot of that going on forever. 60,000
expected to attend Empire Farm Days.
You are on the FingerLakes1.com homepage right now, aren't you?
It's scrolling to the bottom of your face.
Oh, that's right. On the old scrolling
marquee.
Here comes the news.
Yeah.
Is that? Am I bringing it in, Dandy?
Does Bonadon have at Farm Days?
Bring it in the news?
I don't know why. Would I know that?
No, they make teeth, not farm equipment. It's a farm show. The biggest in the state. Some say the world.
They got the road paved up there so that people can go through.
They did pave it.
We're finally talking about how pissed off I get because I can't get to my house because of the line of traffic leaving that place.
Farm Days.
I'm going to bring a fucking paintball gun.
No, you just got to go down Bridge
Street. That'll change things.
Yeah, that's but I still can't get too. Over to that's my house. I still can't get through the line of traffic to get to my house.
There's not one nice guy that's like, all right, come on.
It usually takes me a good 10 minutes of sitting there before some old guy pulls up and will let me through.
It's always an old guy.
Nice old men.
No hurry.
Well, got their cattle in the back.
Let this young wrangler go through to his home.
Well, we should get out of here. It's been about an hour and 17.
Maybe we should talk about the PGA Championship.
No, that we're not a sports talk podcast, though. That's the thing.
Well, that's interesting, because I was just going to say an hour and 17 minutes was almost as long as the women's soccer game today, but whatever.
We unfortunately did not get time to talk about the behavioral sink by Will Wales. Hopefully we'll get to that next time. And if you want, you can email us at info@thesaucepod.com. We'll read it on the air. We're at thesaucepod.com. We're on Facebook. We're on Twitter. Listen to us on Stitcher, iTunes, and we're on Bath Salts. Peace.
We hope you enjoyed listening to this episode of The Sauce Podcast. Subscribe to our feed at thesaucepod.com. Look for us on iTunes and the Zoom Marketplace. Contact us at info@thesaucepod.com. Follow us on Twitter at twitter.com/thesaucepod. We'll see you next week.
FingerLakes1.com